Live from San Diego, California, it's theCUBE. Covering Cisco Live US 2019. Brought to you by Cisco and its ecosystem partners.
Hi, welcome back to theCUBE. Lisa Martin with Stu Miniman, covering day one of Cisco Live from sunny San Diego. We're pleased to welcome back a couple of our alumni. To my right, Eric Herzog, CMO of IBM Storage. Eric, it's always great to have you
great.
And your fashion choices on theCUBE.
Always wear a Hawaiian shirt for theCUBE.
I know, it's a thing. And we've also got Everestus Mainsaw, General Manager of IBM Cloud Private Ecosystem. Everestus, great to have you back on the program.
Thank you very much, delighted to be here.
So guys, here we are, we're in the DevNet zone. Lots of collaboration, lots of conversations. Day one of Cisco Live, but this event's been around for 30 years. Long time. I think Chuck Robbins said this morning, what also turns 30 this year is Tetris. Anybody a big fan of Tetris? So much progress, so much change. I know you've seen a lot of it. Eric, let's start with you. The global economy, what are the impacts it's having on IT?
Well, I'd say the number one thing is everyone is recognizing the most valuable asset is data. It's not gold, it's not silver, it's not plutonium, it definitely isn't oil. It's all about data. And whether it be a global Fortune 500, a mid-sized company, or Herzog's Bar and Grill, data is your most valuable asset. So at IBM Storage, what we've done is making sure that our focus is on being data-driven. It's all about solutions. It's not about speeds and feeds. Of course, having done this for 35 years, I could wax poetically on speeds and feeds, and even have some speeds and feeds that Stu may not even remember anymore. That said, it's really about data. It's not about storage speeds and feeds. How really, storage is that critical foundation for applications, workloads, and use cases. And that's what's most important.
Yeah, so Eric, when they rolled out on stage this morning that 30-year-old box with ribbon cable, yeah, that predated a little bit when I was looking at IT. But I remember when I started in IT, when we talked about security, the main thing was lock the door of the cabinet that everything was in there because it was kind of self-contained. Security's gone through a few changes in the last, 20, 25 years though. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that kind of security resiliency. Obviously something that's impacted the network for a long time, something that IBM sees front and center.
Well, I think the big deal is what most people think when they think of security is I got to buy security software. So I got to call up IBM Security or RSA or the Intel Security Division and buy some security software. And while that's great, the reality is, as many people have written about, in fact, Wikibon SiliconANGLE's written about it, close to 98% of all enterprises, and I mean big enterprises now, are going to get broken into. And you've seen this all over the news. So the key thing is once they're inside, storage can help you with a cyber resiliency play. And at IBM Storage, whether that be data at rest encryption, whether that be malware, ransomware protection, we put together a whole set of technology that when the bad guy's in the house, they can't steal the TV. Because we've locked it down, it's almost as if it was in a safe. Maybe it's almost like the cloak in science fiction where you can't even see the Romulan ship because it's cloaked. Well, guess what? That's what IBM Storage can do for your data, and it is your most valuable asset. So critical to cyber resiliency.
So helping customers go from reactive to this expectation breaches happen very, very frequently every few seconds to being proactive?
Yeah,
eventually predictive?
Well, what we do is, for example, with our Spectrum Protect software, when there's a malware ransomware attack, what happens is they always go after your secondary data sets first. I know that sounds weird, but they go after your backups, your snapshots, and your replicas. Because when they attack your primary data, you can just recover from a backup, they can't hold you for $10 million of ransom. So our Spectrum Protect software, for example, when it sees anomalous activity in backup data sets, sends an email and a warning out to all the admins and says, you have weird activity going on, you might want to check it out, and that way you would know because secondary data is attacked first in a cyber resiliency strategy.
Yeah, the other thing we're seeing a lot is just the scope of what's happening in IT when you talk about things like scale and you talk about edge computing and so much change going on. There's got to be AI in there or machine learning to help us because humans alone can't keep up with what's going on here. Tell us a little bit about that, Eric.
So big data and AI is like the hot topic right now. Cyber resiliency is important because people obviously have been buying security software for a while. So it's more what we do is really an adjunct to that. In the case of big data and AI, it's a brand new open field. Everyone is looking for solutions in both of those spaces. We have created a complete set of data infrastructure we call the AI pipeline. It involves not only physical storage arrays, but a whole bunch of software. In fact, our Spectrum Discover software, which allows you to create metadata catalogs about file and object data, is being expanded, and we already publicly said this in the second half, to include EMC and NetApp and AWS, not just IBM storage. So it's a critical thing, you've got to make sure. The other thing is when you're using AI, let's say you're going to use AI to run a factory. If the storage goes down, those robots aren't working. So storage is that critical underlying foundation, in a big data workload to be able to have this pipeline to get the data. But if you don't have the resiliency, the performance, and the availability of the underlying storage, everything shuts down if the storage fails because the AI software won't run. So that's how we see fitting into there, both a critical foundation, also this AI data pipeline with all of our software.
So before we get into the Cisco partnership with Everest, it's one more question, Eric, for you. As Chief Marketing Officer, you talk with customers all of the time. In that example that you just gave about the criticality of storage for AI, where are you having conversations within customer organizations? Is it at the level of the storage goals and guides, or is it, has it gone up to lines of business, to executives?
Yeah, so from an AI perspective, it runs the gamut. It could be sometimes the storage people, sometimes the infrastructure people. A lot of times it's actually in the line of business or at the data scientist level. On the big data side, it's a little bit more mature, so people know they need to do analytics versus AI, and so when you look at it from that perspective, on that side, it's often the storage guy, but it's also the data scientist as well. So that's who we talk to get things rolling. And so we don't just talk to the storage admin for either of them, because they're both so new, and they have such a big impact on the data scientists and the analytic engine communities inside of those giant enterprises.
I can imagine eventually, maybe it's a question for you, of that conversation elevating up to the C-suite, because if you can't access the data, if it can't be protected, what good is it? Right? It's really, to say it's the lifeblood is a silly thing, we say it all the time, but it's critical, it's table stakes.
Well, one of the things that's interesting is I just got my Fortune 500 magazine at home that had the Fortune 500 list in it, and there was an interesting article on AI in the enterprise, and they did a survey. According to Fortune magazine, 50% of the CIOs that are in the Fortune 500 said they're using AI and big data of some type. So it's sweeping the world, and started, of course, in HPC and the academics, but now it's going into all enterprises of all types.
All right, so we've talked for a few years about the VersaStack partnership, but the last year or so, we've really been talking about where hybrid cloud, multi-cloud fit into this. We talked a little bit at IBM Think, Everest, as we talked at another show about some of the IBM Cloud Private. Give us the update where we are with customers and how that fits. Eric, let's start with you and Everest going to the partnership.
Sure, so from a storage division perspective, we've been talking about hybrid multi-cloud now for several years. And in fact, I did a presentation 2 years ago at Cisco Live on hybrid cloud using the VersaStack. Today I gave one on the data-driven enterprise and why hybrid multi-cloud is important to you. So that was the 30-minute presentation I did today. So I think the key thing is, we make sure that we are hybrid. It's not going to be all public or all private. We can move data seamlessly back and forth. And then also multi-cloud. When you look at enterprise shops, they're not going to use just IBM Cloud. I wish they would, I'm an IBM shareholder, but they're not. They're going to use IBM, they're going to use AWS, they're going to use Amazon, and in many cases, they're going to use some smaller cloud provider. So we make sure that we can move data around across any multi-cloud, of various different providers to a company, but also hybrid cloud as well.
So the status, talk to us about, you know, from a partnership, Cisco, IBM, Cloud Private perspective, what's going on there, Everest?
Well, thank you very much. Well, IBM and Cisco have been partners for a long, long time. And what we're doing now is, given the realities of the fact that most clients have found themselves in a multi-cloud environment, hybrid multi-cloud environment, what we can do to help clients so they can develop, they can test, they can manage the applications in a consistent manner, whether they are on-prem or in the cloud. And there are a couple of initiatives that we are announcing. One of them is that IBM Cloud Private is going to run on HyperFlex, so Cisco's HyperFlex, as well as HyperFlex hyperconverged infrastructure. What it means is a client who currently has HyperFlex can have IBM Cloud Private on it, which effectively means they have themselves a private cloud environment that also connects to other public cloud environments and allows you to really begin to work within a hybrid cloud environment the way that most clients need to. The second initiative is that we will have ACI pods or vPods or virtual ACI running in the IBM public cloud, which basically means that, again, Cisco customers, ACI network customers, who currently use the product on-prem, will be able to use exactly the same control plane to manage their deployments and to manage their security preferences on-prem as they do in their cloud. And this, again, is not running in the public cloud, it's running on bare metal in the IBM cloud.
All right. Everestus, can you bring us inside a little bit the applications? You know, Eric talked about, data we know is so important. Really, it's the applications that are driving that. It's where we're seeing the most change in customers as to how they're moving or building new applications. And in hybrid cloud, it's one of the biggest questions for customers is, what do they do with that application portfolio?
Yeah, so what we're seeing is clearly because clients have now lots of different public clouds. They also have private clouds to deal with them. They have lots of applications that are currently that need to move, right? We believe 20% of those applications have moved. The remaining 80% are still on-prem. And so the trend that we're really seeing is applications moving to the cloud. And the two ways of doing it, you could do this by simply lifting and shifting on VM. You get the contraction benefit of your stack, right? So you get some cost impacts. But the really interesting way that you see lots of clients moving is modernizing their applications, because the real value driver within for the cloud is not so much cost as innovation. And when you convert those applications into microservices, you write them, you run them in containers, it gives you plenty of flexibility. And we're seeing lots of clients that want to use IBM Cloud Private as a platform to enable that modernization journey.
So as every industry is living in this hybrid multi-cloud world for many reasons, what it sounds like to me is that the IBM-Cisco relationship is deepening as a result to enable these organizations that are in these very amorphous environments, as we see the explosion of edge and mobile. That's what it sounds like to me, is that this long-standing partnership is getting deeper and maybe a stronger foundation to help customers not just live in this hybrid multi-cloud world, but be successful so that their businesses gain competitive advantage, they can identify new products and services and revenue streams.
Yeah, I think multi-cloud and hybrid cloud actually requires partnerships, because as Eric said later on, of course we'd like everybody to be on the IBM cloud and it's a great cloud, but we recognize that many clients will have a variety of different clients to deal with. They have a variety of different infrastructures. And that's why when you look at IBM Cloud Private, which is our offering that really enables that hybrid cloud, it is designed to manage that. So it is multimodal, so if you want to run it as a VM, you can. You want to run in containers, you can run serverless, you can run in bare metal. But also, it supports a range of different infrastructure. So not only does it run on Z, it runs on Power, it runs in Spectrum Storage. We announced running now on HyperFlex. It also runs on other people's public clouds. So it runs on Azure, it runs on Amazon Web Services, it runs on Google Cloud Platform, it runs on IBM Cloud. And the intent here is to enable clients to basically manage and work with that infrastructure as if it was one. The way that Stu said, a data center where you locked everything up, well, it's not like that anymore. But the most that we can do is to enable clients to treat all of that infrastructure as one, and that's what we sort of aim to do with our platforms.
All right, I guess last question I'd like to get both of your comments on is your advice for customers. Customers have, that they have a lot of existing things that they have to deal with, that they're looking to modernize. What advice do you give them? Where do you start them? I guess one of the things, you're starting where they are, yeah. But what are some of those first steps and recommendations that you have for customers today?
We have a process that works really well, which is called the IBM Garage, which is effectively a way that we use to co-create with our clients to solve their immediate problems. So a client, for example, who is looking at app modernization but isn't sure where to start, which app, what we do is we get their teams together with our teams, line of business together with IT and our teams, and we spend a couple of days in a design thinking workshop to identify a minimum viable product, which is something that solves the problem, not big enough that it will take forever, but big enough to matter. Then we get our teams, we work side by side, we code it, we test it, we deploy it, We run it in the IBM cloud, we manage it at like in 1 week sprints, and then you spend another few days at the end of week 4 or 5 to do a retrospective, see whether it solved the problem as you expected. And if it did, you pick the next piece of work to continue your journey. So before you know, 5 weeks in, you have your first application modernized, or you have your first native cloud native application written.
Now, from a storage perspective, it's a little bit easier. We supported storage on bare metal. We supported storage in all the virtual environments, KVM, OVM, obviously VMware and Hyper-V, and now we've been supporting containers for over 2 years. So what we say is, leave no data behind. If certain data needs to stay on bare metal, that's fine, we can support that. But we can also transparently migrate data back and forth between the various tiers of container-based, virtualization-based, or the old-style bare metal. So from our perspective, we help them move data around where they need it, and if they're still running in a hybridized world, in this case, containers, virtual, and bare metal, that's fine. If they just go containers, that's fine. If they just go virtual, it's fine. So for us, because of what we've been supporting now for several years, we can help them on that journey and traverse from any one of those three layers, which is where data sits in today's data centers and cloud environments.
So overall, a lot of collaboration, a lot of customer choice. Gentlemen, thank you for joining Stu and me on the program this afternoon. Great to have you back.
Thank you. Glad to be on theCUBE.
Oh, our pleasure. For Stu Miniman, I'm Lisa Martin. You're watching theCUBE live from day one of our coverage of Cisco Live. Thanks for watching.